Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the
become one of the 400 estimated people that die from acute salmonella. Do not put that finger in your...
Oh, you having a rough morning?
Tell me it's all gonna be okay.
It's all gonna be okay. Just give it 5 years.
Year
seven or five...
You have to choose to do something for yourself.
I planned this mom's night thing
what?
For Saturday.
You planned a mom's night?
Yes, sister.
What's the worst thing that can happen?
They could get maimed. I could lose both children. It's getting hot in here.
Wow, you look amazing.
Ladies, tonight is our night, and we look good.
I cannot find a reservation.
I just want to sit down with my friends without three little people clawing all over me.
I'm getting a little angry, and it's doing something ugly to your face.
Joey, you're supposed to be watching our baby. Who has him?
Bones.
He's at the tattoo parlor?
Who would bring a baby to a tattoo parlor? That's dumb.
I know, right?
That is real dumb.
Okay, so here's the plan. We take them inside, get their hands stamped, and they can't get out. Like Shawshank Redemption.
Bones, my baby.
I called Caprice, and Caprice said she'd take him.
Where's the van?
Oh, I had tonight playing out differently in my mind.
We got a baby to find. Hank, where's the baby?
I don't know.
Allie, it's me. Just wanted to let you know that everything's going great here. We're all good. We're going to take a little trip to the hospital.
Life is about finding the meaning and the joy and the purpose in all the chaos.
Hon, your job.
It's hard, I know.
Important. That's what I was going to say.
I don't know how it could get any worse.
Stand down!
How dare you? My husband is pastor.
They just came in here and started... That was an accident.
Well, that's a little teaser for Mom's Night Out on Thursday, May 8th. And if you have an interest in being a part of the ladies group that are planning to go, there is a sign-up sheet out in the lobby at the information table, and we would encourage you to stop by there and sign up. We want to welcome each of you this morning. So glad that you are here, and want to take just a moment to recognize the fact that we have a group of people that are joining us online, and we welcome our online guests as well. As a reminder, tonight we will not meet here for service. It is the Sunday evening that we will gather in family groups. If you have an interest in family groups and you're not currently a part of a family group, there are many across Mustang and Yukon and Bethany and Southwest Oklahoma and I think even into the Tuttle area. So if you'd see one of the staff, we could direct you to a family group where you can get connected with some others and enjoy a wonderful evening of fun and fellowship, as well as a time for us to look at what God is doing in and through our lives. I also want to encourage you to be a part of next Saturday's prayer walk. I think more information will be given to you, or it's in the worship folder, so please give attention to that. Next Sunday is Easter, and there are still many Easter invite cards that you can find located in the at the information desk out in the lobby. I would encourage you, if you haven't already done so, to go out there and pick some of those up. Perhaps you've already given away your 10 and you'd like to give away 10 or 20 more. Those are available, and we would encourage you to do that as well. Next Sunday, we'll have opportunity for two different service experiences, one at 9 o'clock and one at 11:15, and we want to encourage you to come and bring somebody with you. Take a moment now to look at this video on Easter.
82.
In 82, the first International Day of Peace was celebrated.
The famous Hollywood sign was built 82 years ago.
I have 82 friends on MySpace.
82?
82 states in the Union? What? There aren't?
No.
Batman?
In 82, the Commodore 64 computer was introduced.
I bought one. I was born in 82.
82 cents in a dollar? Why?
In 82, Knight Rider premiered.
In 82, Prince William was born.
Dreamy. My dad graduated in 82.
82 stars on the flag?
Oh man, are you serious?
What?
82 stars on the flag.
But here's the most important 82. Researchers tell us that 82% of people who are invited to church from someone they already know will say yes. 82% of unchurched people will accept an invitation by a friend or coworker if they're simply asked. 82%. Easter's next week. 82% will say yes. Did I mention that Easter's next week?
This isn't going to be on the video, right?
No, I'm sure they'll cut that all out.
Nice. Ooh, nickel.
So 82% will come if we invite them. So I hope that you will invite them. This past week, as a part of the Southwest Oklahoma District, we had an opportunity to participate in several different things with our annual district assembly. But one of the very special parts of District Assembly is the ordination service. Each year, as ministers go through the process of examination, through academic study, through the examining of their character, and through their experience, the District Assembly elects individuals to the order of ordained deacon or elder. And this last Monday night, Monday during the day, the District Assembly elected Nathan Keever, our own Reverend Nathan Keever, to be ordained. And on Monday night, General Superintendent Eugenio Duarte laid his hands upon him and ordained him as a deacon in the Church of Nazarene. Nathan, we'd like to ask you to come forward, please, and we want to take just a moment to recognize you and also to present you with a gift that says we appreciate your ministry, we appreciate your answering and responding to God's call in your life, and we too want to affirm his call. So here is a gift, and we're not going to, just open it. We have to admit we got a little help from Abby. But this is his ordination certificate that's framed. Yeah, it kind of disappeared. But would you congratulate again, Nathan, on this wonderful, wonderful event? Thank you.
Comes from Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. I want to encourage you to read this along with me. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Let's take a moment this morning just to quiet our hearts before him as we move into our service time.
Thank you, children, for sharing with us today, and thank you to all of their teachers and workers that tirelessly serve week after week. Let's give them a hand as well. Well, as the children exit and the choir prepare to come up, let's all stand together this morning and greet one another in the name of the Lord. Thank you. As you make your way back to your pew, you may go ahead and be seated. And as you hopefully know, Easter is next Sunday. This is our last Sunday before Easter. So we wanted to share with you one more of our songs from our Easter program. And just a reminder, we still have several hundred invitation cards. And as you heard this morning, 82% of the people that you invite will come. That's incredible, incredible power to change people's lives by simply just inviting them to come. So I'd encourage you, there's a few on the Welcome Center. There's many invitation cards on the back ledge of the sound booth. So I'd encourage you to take advantage of those.
Thank you.
Well, no much more of an exciting message than that, that one day all the darkness will fall away and that Christ will reign again. And that is the hope of the message that we have to extend to our community this Easter. Well, as you're probably aware, we're in a bit of a race theme right now. We've got our lanes down the aisles. We've got our runner up top. Last week, we celebrated Faith Promise, and you all responded in a powerful way. You'll hear more about that later. But we want to sing that new song that we taught you last week called Running. Let's stand together and sing out. I know you all know this, so let's sing out together. The splendor of the King.
The splendor of the King.
be seated. I've been reading on my Bible app a series that's been leading up through the Lenten season, and this past week has been a lot of the story throughout the different Gospels where Jesus prays in the garden with his disciples and that whole interaction. And something struck me a little bit different as I read through that in the different passages, and just wanted to share with you today as we close in on this Easter time and prepare to celebrate what Jesus has done. And that just very simple. Peter, courageous. Peter was phenomenal. Peter has a reputation for sure as being quite a risk taker and doing the things that no one else would do, or being the first. And he's also made some mistakes. And as they've been in the garden, he has words in his head of Jesus saying, "You will deny me 3 times. And you've got to imagine the brokenness that this man who is sold out for Christ has to feel. That his master has said, you're going to just pretend you don't even know me. And so they're in the garden, and now everyone comes out with clubs and swords, and they're ready to take Jesus. And Peter's thinking, this is my chance. I'm going to prove that I will not deny him. So he draws a sword and cuts off a dude's ear. Jesus heals the man's ear and says, "Put your sword away, Peter. This is not what this is about." And so you just have to imagine, again, Peter's defeated, like, I'm trying to do this. What is going on? I don't want to deny him. And one of the Gospels says that before the rooster crows twice, you'll deny me. And so then the following, all through the night, as this scene plays out, he begins to deny that he knows Jesus as he's watching what's happening. And it says that as the rooster crowed the second time, he knew. And the question, the thing that stuck out to me that I want to just bring before you today is, what happened when it crowed the first time? Why didn't he hear that? Why didn't he listen? My question for me, for you today is there a warning? Is there something that we're ignoring in our life? Are we missing something because we're not listening to what God is really saying, or what our circumstances are telling us? That if we just tune in, our perspective might change, or perhaps we'll be able to make a course of correction. I don't know where you're at with that today or what that says to you, but I want to pray and invite you to pray with me that we will be so in tune to not only God but to our world that we're not going to miss an opportunity that he's given to us. Let's pray. And if you need to use the altar for that today, you're more than welcome. Father, you're good. And I thank you for your words. I thank you that you really are not dead, that you're very active in our world and desire a relationship with us. God, thank you for loving us, for caring about us, for giving us life, for giving us an opportunity to experience eternal life, for the peace that comes from knowing you,
for your son, Jesus. And today, as we celebrate, remember this Palm Sunday that the parade took place and that honor was given. May we be mindful of what took place later in the week. God, help us to not do the same, to be so fickle that our world can turn us against you. Give us strength to stand up for you, but help us to listen. Help us to understand what standing up for you really looks like, because sometimes we think it's drawing a sword and cutting somebody, but that is not always the answer. May we live in love. May we embrace your grace. We need you today. Open our hearts to hear from you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
As we think about prayer, we have here in the front our prayer bowls. And for those of you that are guests today, the outside two bowls is designed for request. Whenever we have a request, and you'll see kids go up there and put prayer requests in all the time. The center bowl is designed to be our praise bowl. And today we have someone with us this morning that I know that he has been in both sets of bowls. We started praying for him many months ago when we received the word particularly that there was something not quite right with his intestines and all those kind of things. And then his name has been in the praise bowl because the Lord touched him, and through his own body, through the help of doctors, but most importantly through God's divine power, he has brought healing to Colt David Chamberlain, and this is his first Sunday here in service. So we're going to have you stand up and introduce him, and the camera right back there in the back will put his picture up on the front so that you can see him. We'll get it switched over in just a second there. Chris and Amy, congratulations. Colt was born January the 6th, and there he is up there. Precious, precious little guy. Had to spend a few weeks in the hospital, but got out sooner than expected. And so we are excited that God is answering prayers in Colt's life. And thanks for being here today. We have a little New Testament that we want to present to Colt today. And just to congratulate you, let's congratulate Chris and Amy and Colt today. Thank you. The Lord bless you.
We also want to update you on where we're at in our Faith Promise Pledge Drive and journey. And you can see our runner up there as we are running the race together. And he is standing on $82,000 plus, and that is how much you have pledged out of our goal is $100,000, and we are just ecstatic about that amount right there, though. And so that's all you need to know. If you, though, would like to participate, if you were not here to be a part of that, there is pledge cards still. Faith Promise is our way of funding mission work in our world. And that happens locally right here through food pantry, through local compassion. We pay different things, meet different needs for people. And then around the world, we help missionaries in a variety of places, and we heard from one of them just last week. So that's what Faith Promise is. If you'd love to be a part, there's a pledge card in the registration folders for you to fill out. Let's bow our heads for a moment of prayer as ushers prepare to receive this morning's tithes and offerings, and we worship through an act of giving.
Thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you for the opportunity to come and share with one another and children and just be a part of this good work that you're performing here, Lord. We thank you that we're able to engage in this wonderful race together to give and to and to share and to be really where it's really happening in the earth. And we just thank you for this day and bless you in Jesus' name. Amen.
How are you, Tex?
Why, Madison, I'm as fine as a mud pie and a cow pie. Who are all these new buckaroos?
They're my friends.
Well, howdy. I'm Tex Arcana, and welcome to Texas Dude Ranch.
What's up? See, guys, ranch looks just like it's described in the brochure. Split wall fences surround the rustic barn as the weather vane follows the wind to the beat of the ranch hand vane, making this a one-of-a-kind dude ranch experience.
Have horses? This is a donkey dude ranch.
A donkey dude ranch?
Come on, guys. Didn't you even read the brochure?
No. Besides, we're running a donkey ranch.
Now hold your horses there, Missy.
What if he had any?
Well, neither did the Lord. Jesus walked everywhere he went, and the one time he rode, it was on a donkey.
Yeah, if a donkey was good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for me. Yeah, I'm ready to saddle up and hit the trail.
Well, they're still resting up from their morning ride. Besides, you can't just hop on an animal without knowing something about the breed.
You said donkeys have been around for thousands of years, right, Tex?
That's right. As a matter of fact, my favorite Bible stories are ones with donkeys in them. I call them my donkey tales.
Hee haw, hee haw.
time we came, you said, y'all come back now. So we did.
Well, I'm sure glad you did. And you brought your friends with you. We're going to have a high time, or my name ain't Tex Arcana.
Okay, but when do we get the ride?
Yeah, are your donkeys dangerous or something?
Oh, heavens no. Donkeys are sure-footed.
She's right. Her brochure says that while horses only have 2 hooves on the ground at any one time, donkeys always have 3 hooves down.
Is that why Mary and Joseph rode down to Jerusalem on a donkey?
Well, if they did, that's why. But even though Christmas pictures show Mary on a donkey, the Bible never mentions any animal.
So is there a donkey tale in the New Testament?
If there is, we'll help you tell it.
Rachel.
Somebody's got a helper.
Well, as a matter of fact, I got my Bible storybook right here, and I've got a donkey tale in the New Testament. Comes from Luke chapter 10. Oh, here it is. And it's about a lawman.
Don't you mean a sheriff?
Nope. This was a man who knew all the Old Testament laws and what the prophets said about the Messiah, who'd come and save the people of God. But when he finally met Jesus, he wouldn't believe Jesus was the Messiah. So the lawman tried to trick him with a question.
What can I do to go to heaven?
But instead of giving him an answer, Jesus answered him with a question.
What does the scripture say?
So the lawman quoted a very good law.
Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself.
But the lawman had neighbors he didn't love, including some Samaritan neighbors he outright hated.
Why did he hate them?
Well, because the Samaritans were different. They dressed different and talked different. They even worshiped God different. So he tried to trick Jesus again.
Excuse me, partner, just who is my neighbor?
So Jesus answered him by telling a story. Here now, y'all listen and watch this.
The story about the law of the land, where robbers jumped out from the trail and beat the helpless man. They cracked his head, left him for dead. All the man could do was hope that some good person would ride to his rescue. A preacher man came down the trail, didn't think the man had died, cause the Bible says he saw the man, but passed on the other side. Then a teacher man came along, but he passed the poor man too. Could they be so heartless and forget the golden rule?
Love your neighbor and do for him what you want him to do for you. For the Savior gave this command, that's the law of the land.
A third man rode down the trail, a stranger passing through. He saw the man and he did what the others wouldn't do. He jumped down, took his saddle bag, and with tender care bandaged up the wounded man, but he didn't leave him there. His donkey carried both of them back to a hotel, where this stranger from Samaria nursed the man to health. And we remember him today, this hero good and kind. This day, the Good Samaritan in this law comes to mind.
the story of the Good Samaritan.
That's right, Madison. I call that donkey tale the Good Samaritan Rides to the Rescue.
But the donkey's not a very big part of the story.
Yeah, he's not even in the title.
But read what the Bible says. The donkey carried the wounded man to the inn.
And without his donkey, the Good Samaritan might not have ridden down that trail in the first place.
So maybe we should call it the Good Samaritan Rides His Donkey to the Rescue.
Maybe, but you don't need a donkey to rescue someone. You just need a heart like that good man from Samaria.
Like a good Samaritan, if you care, you can see a need. Like a good Samaritan, when you're there, you can meet it. Like a good Samaritan, if you share, you can change someone's life. So be there, care, share the love of Christ. Like a good Samaritan, if you care, you can see a need. Like a good Samaritan, when you're there, you can meet it. Like a good Samaritan, if you share, you can change someone's life. So be there, care, share the love of Christ.
I'm a kid, but I'm important. I've got work that I can do. I can go to a distant land for help from one right here in my neighborhood.
Like the Good Samaritan, if you're there, you can see a need. Like the Good Samaritan, when you're there, you can meet it. Like the Good Samaritan, if you share, you can change someone's life. So be there, care, share the love of Christ. Jesus' love comes from the Father, and that love never ends. You can have His love.
What John 20:31 says, don't you? But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and by believing in Him, you will have life. And when you put your faith in Jesus, we have life in heaven and love for our neighbors on earth. think of Texas Donkey Dude Ranch.
It's okay. And the donkey part's kind of growing on me.
Yeah, but do I want a donkey on me? I hear they're stubborn and they kick.
Oh, no, Spencer. Donkeys are sweet and smart.
Her brochure says that they herd cattle like a dog, haul more weight than a horse, and eat less than a cow.
That's right. That's why in some parts of the world, a donkey's not only the family pet, but their all-terrain vehicle.
And bring on the ATV. I'm ready to ride.
I'm sure Jesus was too.
What do you mean?
You know all those places Jesus went, teaching and healing and sharing God's love?
You mean places like Cana, Capernaum, and Samaria?
That's right.
But some of those places are up to 100 miles apart.
And Jesus walked to all but one. So if you're wanting a story about Jesus, that's the best donkey tale there is.
Spencer, I think she's going to need our help.
Don't look at me.
Well, now, Spencer, couldn't you do a little bit of yodeling?
What's yodeling?
You mean like old lady who?
Whoa, hey, don't be singing about old ladies around me.
Hey, you're not old, Tex.
Of course I'm not, but this donkey tale is. It's called A Donkey Brings a Humble King, and it's in all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John.
You mean when Jesus rode into Jerusalem for the Passover?
That's the celebration they had every year when everyone took sacrifices to the temple.
Well, here's where the story starts. Now, folks from all over the country were headed to Jerusalem. And when they saw Jesus coming, they were hog-tied with happiness because they remembered everything Jesus had said and done when he was in their town. They were on their way to Jerusalem. Country folks headed for the city. When Jesus appeared, and they ran to him. Did they sing his praise like only country folks can?
Know what yodeling is?
Yeah, but I don't know why that story's a donkey tale.
Yeah, where's a donkey?
Well, fellas, we don't know that people yodeled on Palm Sunday. It just says they praised him. But for sure, it says Jesus rode into town on a donkey.
Like I said, if a donkey's good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for me. But didn't they make fun of him?
Well, some folks made fun of him, just like some folks make fun of him today.
I know this is a donkey, but if I were Jesus, I'd rode in on a huge horse and whipped up all my enemies.
Yeah, but Jesus wanted to show he was a servant, just like his humble little donkey.
So he just died?
That's it?
You mean you don't know the Easter story? That 3 days later, God raised Jesus from the dead.
Yep, he busted out of that tomb to prove he had power over greed and hate and even death.
Then Jesus went to live with God the Father in heaven, where he has a home waiting for everyone who believes in him.
That's right.
First, Jesus had to make us fit for heaven. That's why he humbled himself to be crucified and died for our sins.
Spirit lives.
aren't you glad the Bible's as clear as a cowbell? Once you believe in Jesus, you're saved for eternal life.
So would you say that Donkey Tail made you a believer?
Yep, I sure am.
And the Bible's full of stories to help us believe.
Yep, but now it's time to trade our donkey tails for some donkey trails.
You mean we're ready to ride?
That's right.
But wait, does that mean there's no more donkey tails?
Oh, I could tell you one about Jacob blessing his son Issachar by comparing him to a donkey.
You're kidding.
No, or David loading down his donkey with gifts for King Saul.
Yeah.
Or Samson striking down 1,000 enemies with the jawbone of a donkey.
No way.
Yep, they're all donkey tales and they're all true.
Didn't our kids do a great job? That's a lot of practicing.
Y'all did good.
And I appreciate all you moms and dads for putting up with the hee-haw song all week and some of the other songs they practice with. I know at our house it's gotten a little old, probably the 100 or second 200 times we've listened to it. But I appreciate you doing this. And we've really talked about a lot about the last 6 weeks we've been studying about Easter and what the story means and how that through these musical that and these different songs that we can share the love of Christ to each one of you today. And I hope you could feel God's love through their songs and get just a little glimpse of his story. I'm going to let the kids go ahead and grab a seat here for just a second. I wanted to say a big thank you to some of the people that helped us with the musical, the behind the scenes. And I had a couple, I want to say a big thank you to Misty. She took the drama parts out. If you go ahead and come on up. And she not only memorized her part, but she also worked with the drama team while I practiced choir songs with the rest of the kids. So we appreciate it.
Thank you.
And I had a couple other people kind of behind the scenes that helped me every week. And as I call your name, go ahead and come on up here. We had Emily Wilson, Janae Thomas, Haley Thomas, and Tiffany Thomas. They were here up, and I know on the attendance sheet, names weren't marked, and they were like, were they here? And I was like, yeah, because they were up there with me every single week practicing. So I appreciate all their help. Go ahead and come on up here. And then last but not least, and I'll have Brendan run this back to me for them. I want to say a big thank you to our sound guys back there, James and Mike. A long time ago, it was really easy to get sound guys to help with musical practice because all of the guys had little ones that were in the musical. And I was looking around, and I was like, all of them have teenagers now. So I appreciate these guys coming and giving up their Saturday and Wednesday night to come and help us practice so the kids could do a great job today. So let's just give them a hand as well. Thank you. Run this back to them in the sound booth for me.
Thought I was going to sing, didn't you? Thank you, Pastor Kim, and I appreciate each of your parents. I was just sitting there thinking, our children's church room that they meet in each week is just kind of right up there behind the wall back there, and it's a nice sized room. But when you put 43 kids in there, I have a feeling that room gets really, really small. And I'm really excited to think about as we look out the east door and see the construction going on, that construction is going to reach every area of our ministry. The new part is going to house adult and youth, but by us moving the youth over there, we're going to be able to more than double the size of our children's church room upstairs. That's going to give them a lot more room. So we appreciate your faithfulness in giving so much to help us do that project. Kids, you did a super, super job. And it's always fun to watch you. I love to listen, but I love to watch you because there's always somebody that does something new that I would have never, ever guessed. Just because I think I know you, but you're in a new setting, and I see something new about the way that you do things, and it's fun to watch you grow up, and it's fun to see what God's doing in your lives. I was just thinking of a Bible story as well. You've heard a few Bible stories today, but let me tell you one real quick. Jesus and his disciples were out on the hillside all day, and they were Jesus was telling stories, just like Misty told the stories today and some of the stories you acted out. He was telling stories and parables to all the big crowd, and the disciples were trying to help everybody, and at the end of the day, they were really tired. And Jesus said to them, "Hey, guys, let's go get in the boat, and we're going to sail across to the other side of the lake." And the disciples were all excited about that, and they thought, that's going to be cool. We're going to get away from all this crowd, and we're going to go on vacation for a couple days, and we're just going to have a really good time. But the Bible tells us that as they get in the boat, Jesus goes to the back of the boat, and he goes to sleep, and all of a sudden, the wind and the wave comes, and it just goes like crazy, and the boat's going all over the place. It's being tossed, and the water's splashing up in their face. And they're getting scared. They think they're going to drown. And Jesus is still asleep in the back of the boat. And they go to Jesus and they shake him and they say, "Jesus, wake up. Don't you care that we're going to drown?" And Jesus gets up and he looks around and he speaks. And he says to the wind and the waves, he says, "Be still." And all of a sudden, the boat was just like it was setting on glass. It was still. The winds quit and the waves died down. And the disciples, their eyes were this big. And they were afraid, it says in the scripture. And Jesus said, "What's wrong? Don't you know me?" And the disciples said to Jesus, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." And last night I was at a group and I heard a guy ask and talk a little bit about that. And it struck me, moms and dads and parents, here the disciples had been with Jesus for a few months already. And they had watched Jesus perform miracles. They had listened to his sermons. They had listened and he explained their stories and the parables. But yet here they are in the boat and they're wondering, who is Jesus? And I begin to ask myself the question, how well do I really know Jesus? Just like these boys and girls, sometimes they get up on stage and we find out something new about them. Coming together to church on this Palm Sunday is all about us finding a place where we can find out something new about Jesus. Find out something new about his love for us. Boys and girls, Jesus loves every one of you. And like the story, he wants you to go to heaven. He wants you to believe in him and ask you to ask him to forgive you of your sins. And I hope you've done that. And moms and dads, the same questions for us. For us to experience all that Jesus has for us. For us to know him like he wants us to know him, we need to seek his forgiveness, to ask him to come and live in our hearts so that we truly understand that Easter is not about just a story to tell or an egg to hunt, but it's about a life that Jesus wants to give to us. So would you bow your heads with me and let's think about that as we prepare to close today. Father, I just thank you so much for sending us your son, Jesus. And thank you for these stories that we've been reminded of, true stories, that your word tells us to show us how much you love us. And I pray today, Lord, that even in as we've enjoyed the kids and their musical, and we've heard the story, that your Spirit would come and speak to us. And that even today, for all of us, we would see something new about you today. That we would see something about your love for us that would just affect the way that we live. We love you today, and I thank you for loving us. Thank you for all these boys and girls and for their hard work to learn the words to the song and their parts. And I pray that during this Easter season that you will bless them and that they will be a blessing to you because they will live for you, and help us this week to be a blessing. In Jesus' holy name I pray. Amen. Amen. Thanks again, kids. You did great. And thank you for coming and being a part of this day. Easter next week. We encourage you to invite your friends. Remember, what's the percentage of people that will come if they receive a personal invitation? 82, that's right. So you need to get out, I need to get out, we need to get out and invite people to come and be a part of this Easter celebration as our choir presents a story. Hey, moms and dads, you know what? Boys and girls, you know what? There's some Easter eggs hiding outside. So moms and dads, if you will come up and get your kids, take them to the gym to get the instructions to know what to do for the Easter egg hunt. May the Lord bless you tonight. Hold it, boy, careful, boys and girls. Just stay right here and let your mom and dad come and get you, okay? All right. You are dismissed.